Pentecost. And then there was the Feast of Tabernacles that would come later around October there. So it's during that Feast of Pentecost when there were hundreds of thousands of Jews from different nations coming to celebrate Pentecost in Jerusalem, that there was a word going round that there's a group of people gathered in an upper room who used to be followers of the radical rabbi who was called the Christ or the Messiah, who had died recently, and there was claim he has resurrected. And the story went that in that upper room, not many days before, that there was the infilling of the Holy Spirit, and they were heard from those who were walking on the streets. They heard those who were in the upper room, 120 of them, speaking in their mother tongue. You know, some were from Libya, others were from Asia, who had come to celebrate Pentecost, and all of a sudden they started hearing these Jews, these Galileans, speaking in their language. And the Bible says, as they were there amazed, surprised with what was happening, Peter stood and he preached that day, explaining that what you are seeing today is that which was written by Joel. In Joel chapter 2 and verse 28, Joel had prophesied saying, in the last days it shall come to pass that God will pour his spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions, and the old men shall dream dreams. So that is what was being fulfilled in the day of Pentecost. And the Bible says, out of that sermon that Peter was doing, 3,000 people were converted that day. And they continued together, particularly for the sake of those who had gotten converted. Before they were released back to their countries, they were put in a fellowship by the church. And because they had no homes, they had no food, they had only come for a short period and then they go back home, the apostles and the Christians were forced to sell their properties so that they can share. And therefore, as a community, they lived together, enjoying the possessions of the Jews in Jerusalem. They continued together in the doctrine of the apostles, in the breaking of bread, in prayer, and in worship. They continued together right there in Jerusalem. And the Bible continues in Acts chapter 3 that one day, Peter and John, as they were going to the temple in the hour of prayer, there was a man who for 40 years was sitting at the beautiful gate begging alms. That day, Bible says that Peter and John, they fixed their eyes on this man, and as this man was expecting money from them. And they said to him, silver and gold we have none, but such as we have, we give unto you. And they said, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And the man who was crippled and lame for many, many years, all of a sudden was joining Peter and John, leaping and walking and dancing and praising God. As he did that, there were multitudes of people who came together to see this miracle. They were coming at Solomon's porch, at Solomon's area, right there at the temple. They were coming to see this man who was crippled and lame and now had received a miracle. In an instant way, he had been healed. He had been made whole. As they were watching, gazing, amazed by what Peter and John had accomplished by the power of God, Peter took that opportunity again to preach to these people, like he had done in Acts chapter 2. Now in Acts chapter 3, he begins to preach to these people. And he's preaching to them. That is our text of reading today in Acts chapter 3 and verse 19. And this is what he's saying to them. Repent and be converted, that you may receive the remission the blotting away of your sins, and you shall receive times of refreshing from the presence of God. He's talking to these people as a nation, as a nation. He's talking to them as Israelites, as Jews, people who had rejected Christ, and they had even pinned him on the cross, people who had said, "We will not have this man rule over us." Now he's saying to them that if you believe, if you repent, you shall receive times of refreshing, even as a nation, because it was very prophetic that one day Israel will enjoy peace and prosperity. One day they will be saved from war. One day they will enjoy peace as a nation. So Peter is saying to them, as a nation, that repent and be converted, and God is going to pour his spirit upon you as a nation. But not just as a nation, he's also addressing each one of them individually, personally. And I believe it's a message also to us individually. When he says, repent and be converted, that you may receive times of refreshing. Because every time a person repents his sins and turns away from his wickedness to follow Jesus, to believe in Christ, there is a refreshing that comes when we understand that we are forgiven. We are not condemned. When you know in your heart that you are on your way to heaven, when you know that you know you have a relationship with God, that God is not accusing you of anything, you are forgiven in Christ, there is a refreshing that sweeps our minds, that warms our hearts. That is what Peter is saying right here. Repent that you may receive the times of refreshing. He's referring that you may receive the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Because these people are looking at Peter and John and they are wondering how they could accomplish that. How they could make a cripple walk, a lame person be whole. But Peter is saying to them, don't look at us. There is nothing special about us. If only you can repent and be converted, you can walk in the same boldness, in the same witness, in the same power. You can walk in the same anointing. It is not by power or by might. Peter is explaining, it is purely by the Spirit of God. Jesus had said when he was around in John chapter 7, verse 37 to 39, before he went to heaven, Jesus had said in John 7, 37 to 39, Bible says, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Bible says, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man, and he's talking of any man, if any man thirst, let him come to me and drink. And he says, those who believe, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water. And the Bible says, when he spoke this, he was speaking of the Holy Spirit who will be poured upon the believers or the Christians. And therefore, I want to encourage us that the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, is available to us as a teacher, as a helper, as a leader, as a guide, as a counselor. You don't have to be alone. You don't have to be alone. The Holy Spirit is available. And Peter is saying the only way to receive the Holy Spirit, simple, just change your mind. Just turn around, repent, and be converted. And he promises you shall receive times of refreshing from the Holy Spirit. Now, there are three relationships with the Holy Spirit. There are three relationships with the Holy Spirit. Number one relationship is the Spirit with you. It all starts there. Number one, Spirit with you. That is the initial stage of our relationship with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit with you. In John 14 verse 17, Jesus said, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, but he is with you. Jesus is talking to the disciples before his death and resurrection, and he says to them, the Spirit is with you and is with every one of us. Every person, before we are converted, before we are born again, we have the Holy Spirit with us. You are never alone. He's with you. Even in your darkness, even in your emptiness, the Holy Spirit is with you. In Genesis 1, verse 1 and 2, Genesis 1, verse 1 and 2, the Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness, full of darkness. But the Bible says, the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. Even when the world was dark and empty and chaotic, the Spirit of God was hovering right there over that dark world. And therefore, I want to put it to us that even those who are not born again and they are in the dark and they are living a life of vanity, they have the Holy Spirit with them. They have the Holy Spirit with them. And that it is the Holy Spirit who delivers them from accidents, from maybe that shooting, maybe from that whatever the enemy has planned against them. The only problem is the Holy Spirit may be with you when you're not born again, but he may not be with you forever. In Genesis 6 verse 3, the Bible says, the Spirit of God will not strive with man forever. Right now, he may be convicting you. He may be inviting you. Right now, he may be wooing you into the kingdom. But the problem is, if you keep on postponing, procrastinating, you are being born again, you are committing yourself to Christ, he may not remain, he may not be forever. But there is a negative side. There is a negative side of those people who have the Holy Spirit with them. When you, again, remember I'm saying, before you are born again, before you are converted, the Holy Spirit is with you. The negative side is, of those people with the Holy Spirit, is that they may reject Christ. And rejecting Christ is called in the scriptures blaspheming the Holy Spirit. It is the unpardonable sin. It is the only sin in the Bible you can never be forgiven. Matthew 12:31, Bible says, therefore I say to you, every sin and blasphemy can be forgiven, but the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit can never be forgiven. Now, what does it mean to blaspheme the Holy Spirit? It means rejecting Christ. That is what blaspheming the Holy Spirit means. Because the work of the Holy Spirit with you, is to convict you that you may believe in Jesus and allow Jesus come into your heart. Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit has come, he shall not speak of himself. He doesn't come to introduce himself. He comes to introduce Jesus. Now, when you reject that introduction, when you reject what the Holy Spirit is telling you to repent and believe in Jesus, what you are doing is rejecting Christ, and that is blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. That is the only sin you can never be forgiven. Why? Because for you to go to heaven, you must have Jesus in your heart, or you must be in Christ. Therefore, if you reject Jesus, it is called in the Bible unpardonable sin, the sin that you can never be forgiven. In Acts chapter 7 verse 51, when they were stoning Stephen, just before he died, he said to those who were stoning him, he said, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. And then he said, you always resist the Holy Spirit as your fathers did. You always, that is a blasphemy you're talking about. You always resist the Holy Spirit. That is the negative side of every person who is not born again, though the Holy Spirit is with them. Number two in our relationship with the Holy Spirit is the Spirit in you. The Spirit in you. He has been with you, convicting you, trying to bring you to Christ, to the kingdom of God, but you've been rejecting. Then all of a sudden, one day, you choose to believe. You choose to believe in Jesus. When that happens, we call it, you are converted, you are born again. That being born again is now having the Spirit of God in you. John 14:17. The same verse. Bible says, for you have the Holy Spirit with you, but he shall be in you. He will be in you. Initially, he is with you. Jesus, remember, it's at the Last Supper. The following day, he will be killed. The following day, he will be crucified. And he's talking to his disciples, saying to them, you have the Holy Spirit with you. But he says, in days to come, he will be in you. At that particular time, it was not possible for the Holy Spirit to be in them, because Jesus had first to die for their sins. There is no way the Holy Spirit could come in them. He had to die first so that they can be forgiven. And if you remember when he died, on the third day he rose again, and right there in the evening when he rose again, that evening, Easter Sunday evening, he appeared to the disciples who were locked in a room. And what did he say to them? He breathed and said to them, receive ye the Holy Spirit. It is at that point that the disciples were now born again. The 3 years they were walking with Jesus, they were not saved. Because you can't be saved without forgiveness of sins. They were not saved. They were just disciples, following students of Jesus. But after he died, and then now he rose again. That is a Sunday in the evening. He breathed into them and said, receive ye the Holy Spirit. It is at that point that he came in them. There are those who here are born again. And if you are here and you confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you have the Holy Spirit in you. He lives in you. Bible says in Romans 8:9, no man can say Jesus is Lord without the Spirit of God in them. It's only by the Spirit of God in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. It's only by the Spirit of Jesus in you that you belong to Christ. Also, 1 Corinthians 12, verse 3, Bible says, no man can say Jesus is Lord without the Holy Spirit. No man can say Jesus is Lord without the Spirit. It is the Spirit of God in you that enables you to be able to confess Jesus is Lord. Now, there is a negative side. Just like the way the Holy Spirit with you, when you're not born again, the negative is you blaspheme. When you have the Spirit of God in you, the negative of it is, though you are a Christian and born again, the negative of it is you can grieve him. He's in you, but you can grieve him. Ephesians 4:30, the Bible says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit with whom you have been sealed for the day of redemption. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Now, how do you grieve the Holy Spirit? You are born again, you are a Christian, you are going to heaven. How do you grieve the Holy Spirit? Ephesians 4, now starting from verse 25. Before you come to 30, starting from verse 25 all the way to 31 or 32, all the way to 32, it tells us how you grieve, how you can grieve the Holy Spirit. Bible says right there in verse 25, it says, putting away lying, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Verse 26, it says, so number one says, by lying, you can grieve the Holy Spirit. Another way is, verse 26 says, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down upon your wrath. 27, neither give place to the devil. Don't give the devil a foothold. So anger is a way that you can grieve the Holy Spirit. You're born again. But anger, harboring anger, can be a way of grieving the Spirit of God in you. Neither give place to the devil. Verse 28 says, let him who stole steal no more, but let him labor, working with his own hands, that which is good, that he may have something to give to the others. Verse 29, let no corrupt word proceed from your mouth, praise the Lord, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. So anger, lying, laziness, not working, can be a way of grieving the Holy Spirit. Filthy talk, corrupt word from your mouth can be a way to grieve the Holy Spirit within you. And then our verse 30 says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit by whom you've been sealed for the day of redemption. Verse 31, let all bitterness and anger and clamor and evil speaking be with all malice be put away from you. And then verse 32 says, be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ Jesus has forgiven you. And forgiveness, you grieve the Holy Spirit who is in you. Anger, clamor, evil speaking, malice, bitterness, lying, laziness, all these ways you grieve the Holy Spirit. So if you're not born again, you are grieving, you are blaspheming the Holy Spirit. If you are born again and you have the Spirit of God in you, but you're a person given to bitterness, unforgiveness, you know, clamor, malice, with that, you are grieving the Holy Spirit. So relationship number one, the Holy Spirit with you. Number two, now the Spirit in you. And number three, the Spirit upon you. The Spirit upon you. In Luke 24:49, after Jesus had breathed to the disciples, now they are born again, for them to receive the Spirit in them, he said, abide with us, for it is to, and the days, Luke 24:49. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. He has just breathed the Spirit into them. Now they are born again. But he says, wait in Jerusalem now. You are a believer, you are a Christian. Before you go to preach, or before you go to do ministry, before you go for service as a Christian, before you work for the kingdom of God, he says to them, wait. Wait until you are endued, you are empowered with power from on high. He would say again when he was ascending to heaven in Acts 1 verse 8, when he's talking to the 500 disciples, people who have the Spirit in them, he would say to them in Acts 1 verse 8, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. That is a promise to every believer, every follower of Christ. God wants to give you power to be a witness in that school, a witness in that neighborhood, a witness in that office, a witness in church. God wants to pour his Spirit upon us for us to be able to be a witness. It is the first time that the Holy Ghost came to remain on people. The Holy Spirit in the Old Testament, he used only to visit, like he would come upon Samson. And every time the Holy Spirit visited, there were supernaturals. When he visited upon Samson, when he came upon Gideon, when he came upon David, every time he came upon a man, there were supernaturals happening. And that is what the Spirit, or that is the desire of God for you. God wants you to live in the miraculous. He wants you to walk in the supernatural. But you can't without the Holy Spirit. For Peter and John, they were just nominal Christians going to heaven until the Spirit of God came upon them. That is how they were able to do the miracles and the supernaturals that they were doing. Praise the Lord. Jesus was just Jesus, a son of God. From the time he was born, there is no record of a miracle. Yet he was the son of God for 30 years. But no miracle, nothing was happening. But the Bible says that when time came for him to be ushered into ministry, for him to walk in the miraculous, Bible says in Luke chapter 3 verse 20, when people were being baptized, Jesus also being baptized and praying, the Spirit of God came upon him. Bible says right there, and it is from that time moving forward that now Jesus started manifesting the power of God in his life. If Jesus needed the Holy Ghost to come upon him for ministry, why do we think we can do ministry without? Praise the Lord. If the disciples who had walked with Jesus for 3 years, they saw the need to wait for the Holy Spirit, for them to be empowered. You as a believer, if you want to be serious with your Christian life, it is time to cry, to pray, to wait, to ask for the Holy Spirit. Not just with us or in us, but to come upon us, to enable, to empower us for service. Now the negative side of those who have received the Holy Spirit upon them, who have the manifestation of the Spirit in their Christian life, the negative side is you can quench him. You may be filled of the Holy Spirit. You may have him upon your life for service and for ministry, but you can quench him. 1 Thessalonians 5:19, the Bible says, quench not the Holy Spirit. So you can be filled, what we call empowered, or you can have the baptism with the Holy Spirit, but you can quench him. And how do you quench the Holy Spirit? Verse 20. 1 Thessalonians 5:20. This is how you quench him. Despise not prophecies. That's how you quench him. You quench the Holy Spirit. Verse 19 says, quench not the Spirit. Then verse 20 says, do not despise prophecies. Now, prophecies is one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. It's one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. There are 9 gifts: speaking in tongues, interpreting tongues, prophecy, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discerning of spirits, working of miracles, faith, and healing. They are listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. There are 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. The moment you begin to despise, you start ignoring the gifts of the Holy Spirit, then you are quenching the Spirit of God. Because when you have the Holy Ghost upon your life, God wants you to walk in manifestation of the gifts. He wants you to appreciate and embrace the gifts of God. Can I hear an amen? But the moment you begin despising, you despise working of miracles, you despise speaking in tongues, you despise, you know, word of wisdom, you begin to despise word of knowledge, you begin to despise the gift of faith. When you do that, though you have the Spirit of God upon your life, you are quenching him. Let me say this. Many of us, we say we are waiting. You know, we are just waiting for the manifestation of these gifts. But it is time for us to be actively involved in exercising these gifts of the Holy Spirit. For example, in the days of Noah, as I come to wind up, in the days of Noah, Bible says the dove that had been released, it lacked somewhere to land. So what he did, he came back to Noah. You see, Noah would have said, I will wait for the dove to land on me. The dove is always a picture of the Holy Spirit. He didn't do that. Bible says that there in Genesis 8, he stretched his hand and grabbed the dove and brought it in. So we too, the Holy Spirit is available, hovering over us. But if you wait passively, you will miss on him. You must, like Noah, you must stretch your faith. You must stretch your hand. You must actively grab the Spirit of God for him to empower you and to manifest in your life. So you don't just wait. You do something even as you wait. In the day of Pentecost, they were praising and blessing God. with a waiting attitude. I'm waiting. I'm waiting for the Holy Spirit. So as believers, we must refuse to blaspheme. We must stop grieving him. I want to pose a question to you. Where do you think you are grieving the Holy Spirit? What are those areas in your lives? People may not know, but you know that this is not of God. Is it a lie? Are you living a lie? Are you living in immorality? You are a child of God. Congratulations, you are going to heaven. But you are grieving the Holy Spirit. Are you living in anger and bitterness? You are grieving the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Let's stand up.